Hey guys, so welcome back. I'd like to discuss one more question here today. So the question says, a 60-year-old woman presents to her primary care physician for wellness checkup. She has past medical history of the hypertension and was diagnosed from the hospital yesterday after the management of myocardial infarction. So let's pay attention here. She was discharged from the hospital after having a myocardial infarction, okay? And she came here for what? Wellness checkup. She states that sometimes she experiences exertional angina. Her temperature is 37.5 degrees Celsius. Her blood pressure is 147/98. Pulse is 90. Respirations are 17 per minute. Oxygen saturation is 98. And room air. Physical examination within the normal. What would be the best next step in the management? They have asked us. Okay. So here they have given the options which include atenolol, furosemide, hydrochlorothiazide, nifedipine and nitroglycerin. Right. So let's see what she is going through, which condition she has. Then we'll decide which drug to give here. Okay. So first let's understand she had a history of MI. So what do we understand by MI? During the myocardial infarction, heart is undergoing what? Ischemic changes. Ischemic changes means MI, myocardial infarction, heart had a necrosis due to the lack of blood supply. So that we know she has a MI. Now during MI, what happens? We need to decrease the oxygen demand of the heart. We need to do what? We need to decrease the oxygen demand of the heart. Right? So this is one point. The next point I want to talk here is, see, she has a blood pressure of 147/98. So 147/98 is not at all a normal blood pressure. We need to treat. So when I want to treat, what is she diagnosed now with? Hypertension. And she is having what? History of myocardial infarction. During myocardial infarction, it is always mandatory. We need to decrease the myocardial oxygen demand. So that is our target. So myocardial oxygen demand decreasing, and next thing what we need to do, we need to treat the hypertension as well. So what we need to understand by this, we need to understand during the myocardial infarction, which of the given drug will decrease the oxygen demand as well as the treatment for the hypertension. Let's see which one can do that. Okay. So among the given drug, that includes atenolol. Atenolol is what? Beta 1 blocker. Now furosemide is what? Furosemide is a loop diuretic. Okay. Hydrochlorothiazide is a thiazide diuretic. Nifedipine is a calcium channel blocker which works specifically to the blood vessel. Nifedipine works specifically to the blood vessel. Nitroglycerin is a vasodilator. So among the given options, which of the following which will work with the blood vessel as well as with the blood pressure? Blood vessel as well as with the heart, we need to see. So among the given option, loop diuretic decrease the blood volume. Decrease the blood volume by increasing the diuresis. So when diuresis increase, blood volume decrease the blood pressure. Well, I agree. We are just decreasing the blood pressure. Hydrochlorothiazide is also same thing. It will decrease the blood volume and it will also cause the decrease of the blood pressure. It's very simple. Hydrochlorothiazide and furosemide, they both belong to diuretic. These diuretics, what they do, they will increase the urine output. When I have urine output more, what I'm having, the patient, when I have more urine output, there is loss of more fluid from the body. When there is a loss of fluid from the body, what will happen to the blood pressure? Blood pressure would go down. Agreed, we can use it for the treatment in this condition, but let's see if I have a better option. Because calcium channel blocker, it's very simple. We have a blood vessel, right? Blood vessel has three layers: tunica intima, tunica media and tunica adventitia. So in the tunica media, we have the smooth muscle, right? What CCBs do, if I take out one cell from the smooth muscle, it's very simple. In our body, on this muscular tissue, especially on the smooth muscle, we have some things called as calcium channels. Now what happens, whenever these channels are open, calcium will go inside. Whenever calcium goes inside the cell, what will happen? especially in the muscle cell, it will cause the contraction. Now what I'm talking about, I'm talking about the smooth muscle which is present in the blood vessel. So if I have calcium, what will happen? Vasoconstriction. If I use calcium channel blocker, what will happen? Vasodilation. I will decrease the blood pressure. So calcium channel blocker is a vasodilator. Vasodilator. Okay. Now nitroglycerin. Nitroglycerin also same thing. It also causes the vasodilation. Vasodilation will lead to decrease of the BP. Now let's come back to our atenolol. Atenolol, I told you it's a beta 1 blocker. If it is a beta 1 blocker, we need to understand where beta 1 receptor is located. Beta 1 receptor is located in the two places. One is in the heart. Alright. The second one is in the JG cells of the kidney. In the JG cells of the kidney. Where it is located? In the JG cells of the kidney. Now what happens when I block the JG cells beta 1 receptor? What will happen? That will lead to decreased renin production. Decreased renin production. When I have less renin production, what will happen? My BP would go down. Why? Because no renin angiotensin aldosterone system working. If RAS system is not working, BP will go down. It's very simple. Well, so we have one thing, decrease the BP. All of them are decrease the BP. Now let's see what is the specialty about the atenolol. Now on the heart, beta 1 receptors are located. What happens when I block the beta 1 receptors of the heart? When I block the beta 1 receptors of the heart, that will lead to, when I block the beta 1 receptors of the heart, it's very simple. It will decrease the heart rate. It will decrease the force of contraction. It will cause the negative ionotropic effect. Negative ionotropic effect and decrease the O2 demand. Decrease the O2 demand. Now, what was our target at the first of those? At the start of the video, I had set a target for us. We had a patient with the hypertension along with the history of MI. When you have a patient with the hypertension and history of MI, it's better to use the beta 1 blocker selectively because they would serve the purpose of both the function, because the hypertension will also be treated as well as our MI also will be in that during the MI patients also it will be helpful. So we need to understand why these beta blockers are useful in the patient who has hypertension along with the myocardial infarction. So that's how our beta blockers are useful. So now let me give you two important key points here to remember for you. It's very easy. Apart from this, we remember one thing: ACE inhibitor are useful in a patient. ACE inhibitors are useful in a patient with hypertension plus diabetes mellitus. The only reason is ACE inhibitors are the nephroprotective drugs, as well as they decrease the blood pressure. And the same time, diabetes mellitus will have a diabetic nephropathy. So to avoid that, if a patient is having hypertension with diabetes, we use the ACE inhibitor. And the next last important thing is, if I have a patient with the hypertension and benign prostatic hyperplasia, it's better to use a alpha 1 blocker. It's better to use a alpha 1 blocker because alpha receptors are present in the urethric sphincter. What will happen? It will make the patient to urinate easily, and BPH, the patient will have a difficulty to urinate. At the same time, alpha 1 receptors are present in our smooth muscles. So which smooth muscle? Blood vessels. If I block them, they will do the vasodilation and cause the decrease of the blood pressure. Thank you guys.